By 1964, the all-channel law forced manufacturers to produce TVs with UHF tuners, bringing a sigh of relief to surviving UHF stations. Technology was the great equalizer. Soon, cable would further level the playing field, but first, videotape would change the face of local TV.
I never got used to videotape. The performance level dropped about, I don't know, maybe 20, 25% when it was tape. I don't know why that would be, but there was some kind of psychological thing. When it was live, you could be, you know, the best, and who knew the difference, because there was no proof. So you felt good about what you were doing. As long as you felt good and you felt you were communicating, boy, you wanted to come back again the next day. When tape came in, I found myself picking at this and picking at that.
In my mind, TV was destroyed when videotape came on the scene, because now you do it over and over again. The live commercials are no more.
George used to walk into a newsroom and say, "This too shall pass." He loved doing that. He had seen so much come and go. But he also recognized that there had been a sea change that had occurred during his tenure at Channel 8. And in a way, I sort of represented a lot of what had come in, and he represented those folks who had been there before.
Advances in technology and the demands of a more sophisticated viewer created a different brand of programming. The times, they were a-changing.
When you have a man on the moon, when you have the environmental movement, when you have assassinations, there was such a realization that television could take you where things were happening. Television could show you what it's all about. And so it became obvious, I think, to many people at the station level that the public wanted more, not just in quantity, but in quality. And so you saw news departments around the country expanding their news operation.
News became a viable business product, now supported by ratings, technology, and news-gathering techniques, innovated in part by consultant Al Primo.
Well, when a reporter is live in the studio with his stories, it does give that story and him and the station more credibility. I mean, he was there, he was the eyewitness to the event, and he's back there reporting it directly.
All across the state, news jumped from 15 minutes to half an hour. News went from radio with pictures to reporter-driven stories.
As they headed up to Main Street, the size of the crowds became evident. And a number of times, as the cars crept down Main Street, past City Hall and toward Pearl Street, they stopped while Mr. Nixon reached out to shake hands and wave. More than once, he left the car to wade into the throng, greeting some of the estimated 45,000 persons who lined the way.
Channel 3 made the leap by virtue of its 1974 sale to the Post Newsweek Company, a solid news operation. WFSB News eventually expanded to 90 minutes a day.
News is the most important driving influence of any television station. If you're the number one news station, you're the number one station in town.
Not to be left behind, WTNH 8, formerly Channel 6, adopted the action news format.
Action news, tonight.
We should be seeing a city glowing in the night, but it's simply not. There is no electricity in New York, none to speak of. An incredible happening, one that almost seems to be an impossibility. And here we are, above it all, looking down on other people's misfortunes and just figuring out, well, we're glad it didn't happen to Connecticut. Who knows? Maybe next time, the New Yorkers will be flying over us. This is Ken Bennett with the action camera somewhere over New York.
Bob Norman was another popular reporter for Action News 8. So popular, he later became the mayor of East Haven. Another recognizable public face is longtime Channel 8 consumer advocate, now turned motor vehicle emissions promoter, Mike Boguslawski.
You had a problem, you wrote Mike Boguslawski. We investigated it, we resolved it, we went on the air and did that story, and we educated people. Hey, listen, here's what you can do to resolve your own complaint. And I was always playing. I love people. I care about people.
Newsman Tom Monahan has been with Channel 30 since 1965. The old school journalist is still most satisfied when his reporting affects change, as was the case with Drunken Justice.
Tomorrow night, we'll see how Osuna was able to drink and drive even after the fatalities. And we'll also show you how loopholes in the law may allow him to avoid prosecution on his latest drunk driving charge. I'm Tom Monahan, Connecticut News.
So they changed that law there, and that's one that makes you feel pretty good. It makes you feel pretty good when you take a complicated case and you find out that people are trying to kind of circumvent the law and bend it and so forth. And when lawmakers see the work you did and see your story and then change the law to tighten it up because of that, it makes you feel pretty good.
Let's check in on the lottery numbers tonight. Those of you who are waiting to find out about the...
I took a first television job at Channel 18, which was the old RKO station in Hartford. Went to Connecticut Public Television for a year. And then went between Channel 3 and Channel 8 over about a 20, 25-year period before settling here at Channel 61.
People want to get their news and information from people that they are familiar with, people they're comfortable with, people that they've seen year after year.
The anchor stands straddling a fence between what the TV station wants to say and what the audience wants to hear. We have to somehow translate that and not let the station get away with doing stories that are meaningless.
In the 70s, another household name was Dick Galliette.
UConn basketball coach Dom Perno has a new assistant tonight, and that assistant will succeed Jimmy O'Brien, who went on to become a head coach. Howie Dickenman, the former Central Connecticut State College All-America, has been named the new assistant at UConn. 35-year-old Dickenman has been an assistant at Canisius the past 5 years. Dickenman will begin his duties this month at UConn.
I don't think anybody probably in this generation could probably get the recognition that we had in those days. Because, I mean, you saw only, I was the one that did sports 6 and 11, 5 days a week, week after week, year after year.